Good morning, everybody. I have not been a declared speaker for this session, and my good friend Mr. Atul Kulkarni has taken me by a bit of a surprise. But I'm very happy to see that Maharashtra Economic Development Council has taken up this particular theme of our waterfront and explore the ways of imparting some momentum to our maritime trade. I find that Mr. Atul Kulkarni has touched upon various subjects, perhaps primarily concerning international shipping, including trade and taxation and some of the technical issues. I will limit myself to legal infrastructure that presently exists in India and perhaps what needs to be done from the point of view of the present needs. Somehow I may submit, I mean, those of you who are connected with DG Shipping here or Maharashtra Maritime Board here, some of them may be familiar with the issues that drag us down. Perhaps as all of you know that our primary maritime legislation, the Merchant Shipping Act itself, is a 1958 legislation, which is itself a child of 1923 legislation from the British era. That itself is a come down from 1891 British Merchant Shipping Act. But 1958 Merchant Shipping legislation itself is now, has undergone a change now, and the new draft of the Merchant Shipping legislation is right now in the Parliamentary Secretariat and awaiting clearance from the floor of the Parliament. So I'm very happy about that, although I have not exactly studied thoroughly what limitations the Merchant Shipping Act 1958 are dealt with in the new draft that is now lying on the floor of the Parliament. But many of you may be already aware that our Merchant Shipping Act covers shipping that caters to international shipping as well as it caters to coastal shipping. A ship that is sailing continuously between, say, Bombay and Goa, Bombay and Cochin, has to comply with the same laws as the ships that go from here to New York or from here to Felixstowe, as Mr. Atul Kulkarni has identified. So to my line of thinking, India, with such a tremendous potential for industrial development, we need to separate our international shipping from our coastal shipping and our coastal shipping from our inland waterway shipping. We have to have a clear infrastructural, legislative infrastructure available so that the industries can develop accordingly. Mr. Kulkarni referred to International Maritime Organization, and they come out with all the modern technical findings applicable to international shipping. But if we have a parent legislation of Merchant Shipping Act, which concerns international shipping as well as coastal shipping, then we are being unfair to coastal shipping. See? So somewhere down the line, we need to very seriously address this particular question about how our coastal shipping itself can stand alone based on coastal shipping requirements, which take care of all our major ports and their infrastructure available for looking after the safety of shipboard people. Similarly, talking about the inland waterways, now a lot of things have happened in inland waterways in India during the last 5 years, I find. But again, inland waterways, the legal infrastructure, the original legislation was the 1917 legislation. You see, it was a central government act, and which was expected to be implemented by individual maritime states that we have, I think 11 of them, from Gujarat all the way to Bengal on the east coast of India. But some states have taken a lot of initiative in this area of taking care of their local requirements with regard to design, construction, manning, and operation of inland vesselways, inland waterways. I understand that the government of Kerala has come out with its own set of rules which take care of these technical subjects, and that takes care of Kerala's inland waterways, you see. So that kind of an initiative that needs to be taken care of, that needs to be taken by all these maritime states, Maharashtra Maritime Board, Gujarat Maritime Board, taking into consideration the peculiarities of the waterways, the tidal pattern, the behavior of the ships, the trade needs. See, there has to be a legal infrastructure that provides some kind of an automatic incentive to the entrepreneurs to come forward and take on these activities of state-specific crafts. See, if you go into Bengal, for instance, the Hooghly River, and then connected to all the other Ganges network of various rivers, there is a waterway available all the way up to Kanpur, and you know, even up to Agra and Delhi. So the point here is that such a large waterways that exist around India, you know, I feel there is inadequate legal infrastructure available which will offer the right incentive for the growth of industry. I mean, the coastal shipping now, I mean, he referred to some of the problems, but to identify some of the more basic needs. Now, Indian-owned international tonnage is to the tune of about 800 or 900 vessels. But we are just about capable of handling probably 50-55% of our crude requirements. So nearly 40-45% of crude requirements are continuing to be brought into Indian ports from overseas by foreign flag vessels. You see, our container trade, India's Exim trade in container, is only handled to the tune of probably 15% by Indian flag vessels. Bulk carrier also is the same thing. We are talking of maybe 35-40% there. So to begin with, one can straight away see what a tremendous scope exists for the growth of Indian shipyards, even for international shipping. So a lot that needs to be done. Lot has been done, but lot needs to be done. But coming back to MEDC and the interests along the maritime states, we have to seriously address ourselves about how we can relieve the coastal ship owners from the burden of international requirements emanating from international maritime organizations. So unless we have that kind of an umbrella of a Coastal Shipping Act and probably merged with Inland Vessel Act, you see, this kind of a legal infrastructure we have in place, I don't know how industrialists and entrepreneurs backed up by Indian banks will come forward to take care of our waterfront needs. This is one important thing I would like to submit. There are many other issues, I feel, associated with our coastal waterways. Probably Mr. Kulkarni didn't touch them. One of them is, of course, security, in the sense that if there are any Coast Guard representatives here, I do not know. If Indian Navy representatives are there, but with the subject of security and with recent incidents that have been happening, and the vessel Kabir, I don't know how many of you remember the name of the vessel Kabir that created terror in Oberoi and Taj some time back. And we still have a very serious problem of identifying in our own backyard, in our own coastal waters, to whom the vessel belongs. Who are the people on board the ship? What identification they carry? Are they Indian citizens or are they not Indian citizens? This is such a large marine traffic that exists in our waterways, whether they are ports, whether they are coastal waterways, whether they are bays, whether they are creeks. You see, it's quite a large network of waterways that we have, and I doubt if we have adequate legal infrastructure to really identify the people there who are on the waterfront there, on the waterways there. It's a very serious problem that Coast Guard faces especially. Then, I mean, one very important point I would like to again get back to the legal infrastructure is the subject of limits, the port limits. You see, we have 11 major ports, and each port has its own port limits over which their administrative writ runs. So is the case with minor ports. They have their own port limits. Now and then there are common waterways, which we call under the international laws of the sea, the Indian waterway, the 12-mile belt of coastal run. Now, all this division of responsibility between the central government, the state government, the local minor ports, you see, there is a lot of coordination that is required to be done. Of course, all these problems are also closely associated with the general overall standard of education with people who are connected with sea trades. I mean, Mr. Atul Kulkarni referred to fisheries and whatnot, you know. So we have quite a large agenda in front of us. I have tried to touch upon some of the problems that are really facing the society at large, not merely the industries, not merely the government, but these are all very serious problems, affecting the security of our country and, of course, the growth of trade. We would try and take on some